it is great to be able to talk to individuals about what it is that we do. Alpha Supported Living Services has been around since 1971. And if you have much background or any knowledge whatsoever about where we have come from as far as the American Disability Act goes, there's been a lot of transition and change as time has progressed since the ADA was passed. Prior to that, we all understand that individuals that had some form of a physical or intellectual disability were sometimes isolated, kept in institutions, and not allowed to be part of a society. There were many reasons for that, partly because doctors were sharing the information that these individuals don't belong, they can't function in society, they can't participate or contribute. But as time has gone on, we have learned that that is absolutely not the case. In fact, they contribute. In fact, they play a huge role in society. So our organization is one that works with the state to provide programs where we can include these individuals into society. What do I mean by that? We have brought several clients of ours from state institutions into living in their own homes in the communities. Our residents are allowed to have their own apartments or homes if they're able to afford them. Once they start living there, they also have the right to opt to have roommates or housemates come live with them, just something that you and I would do. Our agency then is responsible for providing staffing that work with these individuals every single day to monitor their health needs, to monitor their social needs, to monitor their level of abilities, and to train them and work with them just to try and build skills on all levels. Several of our individuals have challenges, and we face these things every day to where we have to come up with certain plans to address some of these challenges that we encounter. Positive behavior support plans are things that we develop, and also individual instruction and support plans are also things that we work with to guide us. Our main primary goal is inclusion. We are very big on making sure that these individuals don't just have homes, but that they're actually getting out and building relationships in the society. So we make that a priority. We do offer a very competitive benefit packet wherein we have 403B retirement plans. We offer a paid time off for our employees if you're working at about 30 hours. If you get up to 34 hours per week, you do qualify for our medical, dental, and vision, which is also very competitive. Our company matches what the employee pays so that they're able to afford this easily. And then we have paid time off that someone can accrue up to 9 hours a month, depending on how long you've been with the agency. So that number changes as you continue to stay with us as an employee.
Cocoon House is a nonprofit serving Snohomish County. We serve homeless youth and their families. We are a mid-sized nonprofit. We have about 70 employees. Our work is through three core areas. It's outreach, prevention, and housing. So outreach is the program that I supervise, but that's very boots on the ground, you know, reaching out to youth that are literally on the streets, providing services with case management and different things like that. We also have a prevention program for parents of youth that are struggling. So we have family case managers, we have licensed therapists that work with the families, and then we also have our housing programs, which hires the most people in them. We have 5 sites. So for under 18, we house teen moms, homeless youth, and short-term and long-term in those programs. So Cocoon House is a really fun organization to work for. We're really passionate people. I would say that we're innovative. We are a mid-sized nonprofit, but we kind of keep a grassroots community culture there. We're very passionate about inclusion and diversity. We really play to our employees' strengths and give them special projects that kind of allow them to professionally grow. We're really, really passionate about professional growth. I personally started as a volunteer at our drop-in center in 2009, and I am now the director of outreach. So there is career growth at our agency if you put in the hard work and you fit with our culture. I would say we're casual in a sense, but we get down to business. A lot of I work with a lot of street outreach workers that come to work with ripped jeans and combat boots, and that's okay. And then sometimes when you have to go to a community meeting, you wear something more professional. But it's a nice balance. I kind of like that. We offer benefits for employees that are 20 hours and above. We offer 3 weeks of PTO every year. We offer medical and dental. Employees pay 4% of your income. And that includes vision. Let's see, what else am I missing? We have 9 paid holidays available to you as well. So the hiring process, the most that we hire for is residential staff. That we have to staff our housing programs 24/7. So that's the best way to get your foot in the door. I also, in outreach, hire a couple of outreach counselors that are sort of entry level, but we're always hiring for residential care staff.
One really good thing about our organization is we are all throughout the state of Washington. If you want to live in one place, that's great. If you want to live in one place and transfer someplace else, we have 52 offices around the state. State employees, we have, it's 10 days, I think it's 10 days, vacation days we get. You also get a personal holiday and you get a personal leave day. So you basically get 12 days a year paid leave. Vacation leave, you start at 8 hours a month accruing vacation leave, and then after the second year, it increases by 0.7, and it tops out at the 16th year where you're getting almost 15 hours a month vacation leave that you're earning. Sick leave is 8 hours a month, and that stays the same for everybody. You cannot go over 240 hours of annual leave. You cannot accrue more than that by the end of your anniversary year. But sick leave, you can accrue as much sick leave as you can. The hiring process. We have a golden key here. And the golden key is careers.wa.gov. And I have flyers for that. You go into careers.wa.gov, you fill out your profile in there. And then you tell them, these are the jobs I'm interested in these areas. Every day, because I still look for jobs, every day I get an email from them with every new job that I'm interested in the location I want to do. If I want to apply for those, I just click on it and I say, I want to apply for this. It automatically puts my profile to that job, and I am done unless it's asking for additional questions. What we look for is, when you come in for that job interview, come in dressed like you're coming in for your first day of work. Be ready for that. We want to see how you think you need to look for the job. And the best way to do that is go to the community service office, see how the workers are dressed, and dress one level up. A lot of people, candidates that come in, have a hard time talking about themselves because if they're bragging. You don't want to hear. If we usually tell you have 30 or 40 minutes for a job interview, take that 30 or 40 minutes, tell us stories about yourself. Tell us what you've done. Tell us how you related to the public. Tell us what volunteer work you've done. Tell us your stories of what's happened to you. That's how we're going to communicate. If you just have the one question we almost everybody asks is, what is one of your skills? Well, I'm a people person. And then they're done. I want to hear why you're a people person.
You probably know that human services is about relationships, and everybody knows everybody. Everybody talks to everybody. People are connected, whether it's through clients, family, grants, just in the way you share and support each other through your services. So my number one advice to give when you're looking for a job is to not talk negatively about another agency or a person in particular, because everybody is connected in some way, shape, or form, whether it's formally on LinkedIn or if it's informally just through relationships. And so Hand in Hand has 3 programs. We run a place called Safe Place. Some may have heard of it. When kids come into foster care, they come into our Safe Place shelter, and we keep kids up to 72 business hours to allow the state adequate time to find a foster parent, a family, a friend, somebody to take these kiddos on. And so that shelter is primarily run by volunteers and interns. So we are always looking for people to fill those positions, because we are a small nonprofit and we have the staff, just as you do residential care, 24/7. That takes a lot of people. We're always needing people. And then the other program, which I head up, is called the Village Impact Project, and we serve those that live in abject poverty on Casino Road. And I don't know if anybody's familiar with Casino Road. It's 90% abject poverty. It was the third removal rate for child protective services for a long time. There's a lot of gang violence. There's a lot of drug and alcohol, mental health going on in that community. And so we are trying to infiltrate that community and build relationships within the families that are there so that when kids are in need or kids are being abused and neglected, that we have people around them to take care of them if it's not their actual parents to do so.
I'm Amanda Roman, HR and an admin coordinator at Housing Hope. I am second in charge of our HR department, which is not very big. However, we do have a growing company, a fast-growing company. When I first came on in 2015, I started out with 92 employees, and now we have over 145.
Wow.
We will be, we're pulling our property management in-house, which also means that we're going to be expanding our employee base. And so by July 1st, we should have over 163 employees. So we've expanded our services to wraparound services with our case management. We call them our family support coaches because they're there to help, they're there to support the families. But they do the case management type roles. They help out with DSHS and getting bus cards and education. Employment and child helping out with your children because there's a lot of the things that go along with that. We are definitely a relationship-based management company, as in most social services companies are. We work off of an appreciative inquiry HR management tool set, which I don't know, a lot of people don't know about it. Some people do, and it's really great to talk to them when they do. But basically, when you are working, you are in a mode, and you're not always observing what you're doing, how that affects you, or anything like that. With appreciative inquiry, it's an ongoing conversation with we have our supervisors do with our employees about, how's it going for you? You had a really tough day the other day with this event, but you made it successful. What was the skill set that you brought that made that possible?
So I am Nora Karina. I work for YWCA, Seattle Kings, Snohomish County. Within those two counties, we have over 30 sites and close to 400 employees. And what I'm going to talk to you today, I'm going to give you a broad overview, very briefly, of everything YW does in the two counties. And then I'm going to talk to you specifically about my department. My department is Housing Services. We do a lot of work with Housing Hope. Whereas Housing Hope came to this work as a developer who then got into providing services for the people that they developed and grown from that. We came in as a service provider who then began doing development. So YWCA began over 100 years ago as a women's program. That is our heritage and we stick to it. We have a tagline some of you may know, eliminating racism and empowering women. We also are the first to say that we are no way there. We are. We see that tagline as something that is aspirational and something to which we hold ourselves accountable to. Right now, one of the really useful tools we use a lot is motivational interviewing. That has its limits, but it's a good place to start, and I recommend that anybody come to us understand, really understand, how motivational interviewing works as far as a skill, because that's probably the best model we've got right now. But you have to make sure that when you're showing up for work, it is not about you. It is about the client. And your stuff is well taken care of and well enhanced so that you're not transferring your crap onto your client and giving them the additional burden of having to take care of you. And so when you sit in an interview with me, you're going to be asked this question. You're going to be asked a lot of questions about race. First question I'm going to ask you about race. After I ask you why people are homeless, the next question I'm going to tell you is I'm going to say that in this job you are expected to do your work through a framework of anti-racism, and I'm going to want to know what that means to you. And I'm okay if you don't really understand that question. And I'm okay if you don't come to me with a full understanding and analysis of what racism is in terms of structure and in terms of implicit bias. But what I do want to know is that you're someone who wants to learn and is open to learning about that, and that you're not going to do harm to our clients of color, to our immigrant clients, to to our poor white women clients who are dealing while you're learning. So what I don't want to hear is, I don't see race. What I don't want to hear is treat everybody the same. When you come to your interview, when you send me a resume that you wrote for the job. When you send me a cover letter, send me a cover letter that you wrote for the job with the proper title on it. And at the end, when I ask you, after you ask your questions, and when I ask you if you have anything else, if you want that job, ask me for that job. Pitch that job. Nobody makes the ask. If you go in and you learn sales, I worked for Reading Retail for years, you have to ask for the sale. And so many people don't say, pick me, here's why. When they get to the job, they just go, oh, thank you, this looks very nice. Sell yourself. Tell me, after sitting here and having a 45-minute conversation with me about who you are and who we are and what we're looking for, I want you then to say, this is why I think I would be good. And sell yourself to me.
Friends of Youth has 25 sites in 18 cities. We go from South Everett, kind of the 405 corridor, down to Renton. We dabble in Seattle. We go all the way out to our brand new office that's opening in North Bend in early June. We're very excited about that. We are mission and vision driven. Our vision is that all youth have the opportunity to succeed. So we kind of, anything we do, we follow our vision, our mission, and we have six values that lead all of our work. The best place to find jobs about Friends of Youth is our website. It is updated a couple times a week. If you are on there often, you will see that there are a couple jobs that are there all the time. Our residential youth counselors, we always need. It is a job that people often come into straight out of college. They get their experience. We know they're going to move on. We hope we have them for a year, and then it's kind of their moving up. So there are jobs that we need all the time. That is the same with what we call our relief, but those people who just want to get some experience and work a weekend a month, we have those jobs for you. We are looking for the fit for us, and it needs to be a great fit for you. So ask questions. I love when someone asks me a question at the end of the interview. It is one of my favorite things. My pet peeve, on the other hand, is if you send me a cover letter and you've misspelled my name, you've called me Mr. Connor, or the cover letter is addressed to another organization.
Oh, yeah, I have that.
Those attention to details are the first things we're looking for, and that's what's really going to get you through the screen. Spelling errors. Have your friends read your cover letter for you. Our CEO, those things stick out to her, the misspelling. So those are really, like, if you take anything away from what I say, cover letters, they're what gets you in the door for us. So make sure that they're correct. We're all here for the work, for the mission. You're not going to make your millions working for a nonprofit. So we really want someone who believes in our mission and helping our youth.